It's the I Can't Mom Today podcast with Heather, the new mom, and Vera, the seasoned mom. I Can't Mom Today.
Hey, this is Vera and Heather back again with another episode of I Can't Mom Today podcast. Hi, Vera.
Hey, Heather.
How are you?
I'm good. Hanging in there.
Good.
I really need a shower, but luckily you can't smell me.
Just don't shave your legs.
Oh, yeah. I haven't bothered to do that either. Are you kidding me? I did shave my armpits the other day, though. Sorry,
ooh,
TMI.
Oh, meow.
Yeah. So, yeah. How about you guys? How's Baker? How's Brad?
Good. TV's our best friend right now.
Yeah. Well, you know, that whole like screen time limit is out the window, I think, for most people.
I know. We just have to... whenever we have to make deals with them, and meaning like we have to say, hey, after this is over or when this alarm goes off, and we have to make him look us in the eye and repeat back to us.
Yeah.
Because otherwise he's like, okay. I mean, he's a teenager already.
Oh my God. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I remember that. Well, yeah, I'm still living it. I've got a teenager. So
I know.
There you go. So we're continuing on actually from last week. We have Stephanie O'Hara, authoress. Say, hey, Stephanie.
Hey, how are y'all?
Good. It's awesome to have you on again. Thank you so much for joining us and continuing to talk about your book. It's called Angel Wings, and it's coming out in August. So you're in the put a bow on it stage with it right now, it sounds like.
Yes. Yes. So excited.
It is a fascinating book. And in case you didn't get to hear our last podcast, it's a memoir that Stephanie discusses her journey with, and say it again, I forget the technical term.
Secondary infertility.
That's it. Okay. I'm never good with technical terms. Secondary infertility, which is going through infertility after you've already had a child, correct?
Right.
Okay. So you got it. I've learned a lot. But it's a really fascinating, it's a really good read, and it's really fascinating to hear about your journey and how you've made it through 7 miscarriages, moved on to surrogacy, and now have 2 beautiful twins as a result, which is just amazing. So last time we had talked about, when we wrapped up last week, we were talking about how you made it through all those miscarriages and all the disappointment and all the feelings that go along with all of that, and touched on how faith helped you a great deal. But you also mentioned that you can't just pray to God and say, okay, God, do this for me. It doesn't really work that way, that you need to take an active role in your life and you need to take the steps necessary to try and make these things happen. And I mean, you're obviously walking proof of that. I mean, how many people say, oh, I got to write a book? They never write a book.
No.
You actually wrote a book.
You know? Well, let me tell you, it took 2 years to write it after having the twins. So it took me a lot longer.
But you wrote it with twins.
Yeah, and not to mention Aiden, your oldest child too. So 3 kids, and you have a regular job too, don't you?
Yeah. Well, at the time I did. I have since, when I first started writing the book, I had a restaurant, and my husband and I are in healthcare. But since I really founded Angel Wings, I've stepped down from my entrepreneurial roles and our businesses and have focused just on this. This is really my passion project, helping women that are going through miscarriages or infertility and exploring surrogacy. I'm mom, and I am just a writer and a big advocate for women that are experiencing infertility.
So how do you put yourself out there? Obviously the book, but what are the ways, since the book isn't out yet, that you've found to be able to reach out to women and help them out?
So on a local level, I've been very open in our community. I live where the University of Oklahoma is in Norman, Oklahoma. And
I've been there.
So the newspapers, yes, Boomer Center.
Boomer, yeah.
Heather's husband, Rad Brad, that's his name, right?
Yes, that's what we call him because he's Rad. And he's Rad.
Brad.
His like main focus right now is like, just has to be over by football season.
Yeah, exactly.
They're nuts there. Nuts.
Yes. We are fanatics about football. So our local newspapers have done some articles. Of course, I blog about it. So people know here locally how to get in touch with me. And I've met with women over coffee that are, you know, going through their first miscarriage or exploring IVF or even surrogacy. So I've met with probably, you know, 50 or so women one-on-one. But then I also do blogs, and I've done some podcasts of my own. Haven't had time to do those lately, but and then I have my website, yourangelwings.net, that has a lot of, you know, support material on it. I'm on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram as well. So just, I try to use different mediums to spread the message of hope and encouragement to those that might need it.
While we're on the subject, why don't you go ahead and plug your social media accounts so that
people can find you
and I can write them down in the show notes.
Yeah. So on Instagram, it's Angel Wings Steph, and it's the same for Twitter.
It's S-T-E-P-H. And then my website,
S-T-E-P-H.
Yeah. And then my website is yourangelwings.net. And then on Facebook, it's also Angel Wings Steph and Your Angel Wings.
The internet is so amazing. I mean, I'm aging myself, but I remember the time when you couldn't find all those resources. And like you mentioned last week about how you walked into the bookstore saying, I'd like to find a book on miscarriages. And that was really, you know, you went to the library, you went to the bookstore, you couldn't just pop on your computer and find some of these resources like you can now.
Right. So
it's
true.
Really, you know, and then to be able to interact with you, you know, somebody can send you a message and say, hey, I'm going through this or whatever. It's such a blessing to have that. Of course, with COVID, it's a blessing for even more reasons than usual.
Absolutely.
So what are you guys doing to, so you've got the three kids and your husband and then everything going on. What are some of your go-tos that you've been using in order to stay sane?
Well, a little champs at 5 o'clock. A glass of champs is never a bad idea.
Yay.
Yeah. You know, we are outside a lot. I was looking at our forecast over the next 5 days and it's going to be cold and rainy. And I'm just going, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? So we are, we do a lot of walks, and my husband grew up on a farm and my in-laws still live there. So on the weekends we go out there and help work cattle and, I don't help work cattle, but Dirk and Aiden, and they do.
There you go.
I just open gates, and so it's just really great that the kids can go out there, and it's, you know, it's springtime on the farm, which is the sweetest time. So there's, you know, lots of spring calves that are being born, and we have a horse, and they get to jump hay bales and ride in the tractor and just get some sunshine.
Oh, so, I mean, you think about that, like I am here in Florida, the weather is beautiful, you know, this time of year in Northern Florida as we live for, you know, the spring, even with the pollen. And it's just, again, like I've got a big, huge backyard. We live on a lake. So we've been able to do, you know, my son's been able to go fishing and all that kind of stuff. And I think my heart, it goes out to the people who are living in big cities and little tiny apartments and don't have beautiful weather and can't leave their apartment. And they have kids and they have to homeschool them and they have a job. I mean, I don't know. I count my lucky stars every day that I can just go outside and, you know, hang out by the pool or whatever, and my son can go fishing, whereas these other people are just really stuck. And I just, oh my gosh, I can't.
Literally in isolation. Yeah.
Yeah.
I have a friend that writes for the New York Times. We went to high school together and lives in, you know, he lives in Manhattan with his partner and their two kids. And he is just getting over coronavirus. And, you know, we've been just chatting back and forth. In fact, you know, I'm an Okie and we love to give gifts. So we sent him a big care package for, you know, him and his kids and his wife and just, you know, some Oklahoma love. But, you know, yeah, they're stuck at home. And it just, you know, I cannot imagine being in the big city and not being able to get outside and get some fresh air.
You know,
fresh air can do so much good.
Oh, absolutely. Well, and the vitamin D, it's good for your immune system. You know, you get some sun, a little bit of sun. I actually did that yesterday. I try not to go out in the middle of the day because the sun is too strong, but I went out at like 3 and just sat outside in the sun for about half an hour and just felt good. You just feel good. You get a little sun on your face.
Mm-hmm.
It does better.
It does.
Yeah.
So yeah, we've done things like that. And then we're trying to like spread a little cheer in our neighborhood. So we've organized like it was called a heart walk, where everybody, all the neighbors put a heart in their window, and you could write an inspirational word, and then the kids would go around the neighborhood on their walks and count how many they could find.
Yeah.
And then the one that found the most won.
Cool.
So that was really sweet. And then we did chalk your sidewalk. And so we would write inspirational messages, you know, to our neighbors. And when they would go on the walks, they would, you know, be able to stop and see artwork or whatever it was that people had written. So that's been fun.
Yeah, that's cool. I like that idea.
Here they did a bear hunt where they put stuffed animal bears in the windows. And then now we're doing 8 p.m. howls at night.
What's that?
That they gosh, what is that?
Oh, let me spread the word. So just so the idea is that you go outside and howl at 8 p.m. every night. And it's to kind of like...
After your three glasses of champagne.
There's a whole website. You know, Baker does it. He's enjoying it. But it's just kind of sending it out that, you know, you're not with your people right now. And kind of,
that's cute.
It's kind of like a fun
community. Oh my gosh, I love that.
Yeah, last night wasn't as loud. There were some kids that didn't do it that you can hear in the distance, like just like, hey, this is so funny. And they're really loud, but we couldn't hear them last night. But it's fun. It's a great community thing. It's just been growing and growing here.
Yeah, because especially, the kids are cooped up or whatever, you know, to get outside and go, oh, you know, that would be cool. Well,
I'm totally going to steal that. That is fantastic.
Yeah.
I mean, I wish it out. Evan, so Baker's not up too late, but whatever.
Oh yeah.
Love it.
Well, that's even my son, you know, we have an 11 o'clock curfew throughout the county for anybody, no matter what age you are. And he's been obviously doing his school from home. So he's been able to sleep in. He's been sleeping till, actually, I'm quite proud of him. He's been getting up about 8:30. So it's not like he's been sleeping till noon. But I'll say, well, still, it's still a school night. I want you to come home by like 10 or so. And he's like, Mom, why? I mean, I'm getting my schoolwork done. Come on. You know, and then, of course,
my gosh.
Well, can I come home after 11 because I'm at so and so's house and it's just down the street? And I'm like, no. No, you're not supposed to be outside after 11 o'clock. Get home. So that's been a little bit tough wrangling. So anyway, but yeah, so if you have little ones in the house, to be able to let them go outside and scream real loud, I love that.
So cute. I'm totally going to steal that idea.
That is really cute. That's so cool.
Love it.
Yeah.
Love it.
Oh, yeah. So spread the word. Start howling at 8.
There you go. Yeah. You'll have to, you know, do like a little FaceTime live of it or something.
Yeah.
That's a great idea.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, it's like the people in Italy, you know, that stand out on their balconies and sing together.
Yeah. That's so cute.
It is really cute.
It is.
Leave it to the Italians. My heart breaks for them. It's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Did you have any other questions about the book, Heather, or Stephanie?
Well, I just wanted to kind of like dig in with the surrogacy thing, like I've said often, and to friends that have had fertility issues, and it's like how, and this may sound insensitive, it's not meant to be, but it's like, do you want to be a mom or do you want to be pregnant? Because it's a definite difference.
Right.
Pregnancy is amazing. It's just like this insane, like as much as it sucks, it's also so incredibly amazing, but that's just a part of it.
Yeah.
And the mom aspect is so much more than that pregnancy piece. And so, I know I've had a friend that struggled and is still does not have kids. And I've, you know, her husband's very much so like, I don't want to adopt. And I'm like, you know, you got to get past the genetics and you got to get past the thing. If children is what you want.
Yeah.
And I'm sorry if you feel differently and that's okay. And we can agree to disagree, but that is my stance on that. But I think it's amazing that medically you can have these options of having a surrogacy. And, you know, there's some people that take it. I don't know the details of the story. I don't know that people volunteer and they're like, no, I'm your friend. I'm your sister. I'm your aunt. I'm your whatever. I want to carry this baby for you. And that's amazing. Right. Uh-huh. But not everybody has that. So I'm sorry. I'm a soapbox. I'm going to put that away.
Well, no, so the way that it came about for us was, you know, again, we never had even considered surrogacy. It just was not on our radar. Mm-hmm. When we started having miscarriages, we started exploring adoption a little bit and kind of, you know, put our name on an information list through our local adoption agency and just started kind of, you know, thinking about that, praying about that a little bit. We went through IVF and I got pregnant. This was the very last time that I got pregnant. We had gone to CCRM in Colorado, Dr. Schoolcraft. You had spent a lot of time, a lot of money on our infertility journey. And I did get pregnant. And then I'm trying to think of how far along I was. It escapes me at the moment, but I miscarried and it was very dangerous and it was a partial molar pregnancy.
What does that mean?
And
sorry.
Yeah. What is that?
So the cells and the embryo are multiplying so fast that it's almost like a cancer.
Oh.
And it's very, very dangerous. They weren't sure what was going on, but my numbers, my hormone levels were just insanely high. Dangerously high. So I started miscarrying in church. And at the time, you know, I was in the trenches in faith. And when I miscarried in church, let me tell you, I was so mad at God because I felt like I had prayed and he had taken me down this path. And, you know, then this happens and we had spent so much money on this treatment and going out of state and being away from Aiden. And I was just devastated. Mm. But what I realized was I was really upset with God and I knew he could take it. You know, I knew that, that he would, you know, listen to me and I didn't really turn my back on him. I was just really upset. But I also knew in my heart that it wasn't the end of my journey. And I just trusted. And so I think that's one of the things that we don't ever talk about is how we do get frustrated with God at times when bad things happen. And mm-hmm. that's okay. And so I talked to my pastor, who is a phenomenal woman, a dear friend, and we kind of sorted through all of that. But I came out the other side and we had these embryos left over that were frozen at CCRM. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And my very best friend said, let me carry for you.
Oh my gosh.
And I told her, I said, I swear that is the nicest thing that anybody has ever offered me besides like proposing to me. That is just the sweetest thing.
Yeah.
And so we flew out to Colorado and she went through the one day workup and she was poked and prodded and given a psych test and just, you know, like all these things that just brought tears to my eyes that she would do that for us. Long story short, she was put on her regimen of fertility meds. And we tried 3 months in a row and her body just would not really cooperate with the meds. And so we had to stop. And at that point, my husband and I kind of looked at each other and thought, you know, we were going to explore adoption at that point, but we had these embryos that were ours. And so,
what do you do with that?
Yeah, exactly.
Right. What do you do with that? And so I always like to say I talked to my 80-year-old self, and I think anytime that you're questioning a big life choice, if you talk to your 80-year-old self, what would your 80-year-old self tell you?
Interesting.
I didn't want to have any. And so I didn't want to have any regrets, and neither did Dirk. And we just we were financially blessed to be able to afford surrogacy. It's not cheap. I'm going to be really honest, and I don't ever get a lot of flack, but I do have people that ask, you know, why didn't you do adoption instead? And, you know, do you realize how lucky you are that you all could afford to do surrogacy?
Yeah.
That's part of the reason why I've written this book. I want to make people aware. I want to hopefully encourage sisters or friends to maybe carry for a loved one and offer this, you know, carry for them if they're struggling with this. But also I want to highlight it and make it more affordable for people. It's just crazy. Really, the only people that you ever hear about that hire surrogates are celebrities, let's be honest.
Yes.
Kim Kardashian and, you know, there's a whole list.
And she got flack for doing it too. Like people were like, oh, you don't want to ruin your body. And she's like, no, legitimately, this is a health issue. I cannot carry any more children.
Yeah.
Right. It is controversial, you know, to some people. Mm-hmm. But we ended up going through an agency, and I mean, the whole experience of going through the agency, that's a book in and of itself.
Wow.
But we reached out to two different agencies, and I had not signed a contract, but within a few hours I had profiles coming through of women that were available.
Dang.
To carry, you know, your baby. You're getting all of this information and pictures of these amazing women that will carry your baby for you. And they bless their hearts, they have to, like, you know, bare their souls and give their health information.
Yeah.
You know, to you. And so we looked through them, and it was probably a week later that Tiffany's profile came through, and I looked at it and I knew that she was the one. And the whole thing was surreal and weird. I'm going to be really honest. It was, you know, because again, we never thought we would be doing this.
Yeah.
But when I saw her, we just knew. And she lived in Dallas, in the Dallas area. And so we talked on the phone with Tiffany and her husband, Brian, really hit it off. And it was really important to me to find somebody that had had their own kids and that had been through surrogacy before. Mm-hmm. It is, you're right, going back to what you were saying earlier, it's very emotional, and it takes a very strong person to be able to be a surrogate, because, yeah, you know, once you give birth, it's really over. And so Tiffany had carried for another family and was faithful like us, was very strong. We just really hit it off over the phone. So we met, and it took 9 months from the time that we met until the time that we went to my fertility specialist. Lots of, you know, legal aspects, insurance, and those sorts of things, which for anyone that's interested, they can go to the website, and I've written all of that out, because it took us such a long time. It took us, like I said, 9 months to go through it. If we can save headache and hassle for anybody else,
yeah,
we are happy to share that information. But yeah, so then Tiffany went through IVF, and we were there with her, and we found out 2 weeks later that we were pregnant, and then 2 weeks after that, found out that it was twins, and I almost passed out. And
yeah.
Now, was it two embryos implanted, or was it one that split? Uh-huh. Okay, so how did that conversation go? Like, hey, so we're going to, how many did you wind up implanting, or I don't know what the proper terms are, but how many embryos did you transfer? Yeah. And was going in it, was Tiffany like, yeah, cool if you have twins or whatever, that's totally cool? Or was it like, hey, one's mine? I'm just kidding. I know the
So she, having been through it before, she kind of knew the ropes. And they want you typically to transfer two embryos because it improves your odds of getting pregnant. You have, I mean, depending on the fertility specialist, we were told we had an 80% chance of a positive pregnancy had we transferred two. And so when I went through IVF with Dr. Schoolcraft, me personally, I had one transferred into me, which, you know, and he told me, he said, now, you know, by transferring one, Stephanie, your chances of getting pregnant are only 40%. And I said, I understand that. But obviously I lost that pregnancy. And so it was the right thing for me. But with Tiffany, we knew we wanted to, again, going back to what I was saying in the first half of the podcast, we wanted to set ourselves up for the best chance of success. And so we transferred two. And we knew that there was a good chance we'd have twins. And we thought, well, hey, we've been trying for 6 years. So if we can have twins, great. And
yeah.
So sure enough, a boy and a girl.
And they're cute. I looked at your website. They're adorable.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. Stella and Smith. Aww. They're like a little old married couple. They are hilarious.
Aww.
So we got our happy ending, and it wasn't on my time. It wasn't on my terms, but, you know, we stayed faithful to God and never gave up hope. So, you know, Dirk, my husband, is 50 and I'm 46. And, you know, we kind of laugh because we've got these toddler twins running around in our house. But, you know, that's just how it happened to work out for us. So my surrogate, Tiffany, we still keep in very close contact. In fact, we see them, they come to birthday parties.
Aww.
My sister lives in Dallas, and so just a couple of weeks ago, Tiffany's, before all the corona started, Tiffany's girls babysat the twins and my niece and nephew in Dallas. And Tiffany and I have started a ministry called Baby Blessings together. Uh-huh. And it's a support ministry for anyone that's gone through a miscarriage or, you know, gave birth to a stillborn baby or that has, you know, prayed for a baby and hasn't had one. We have little knitted baby hats and pocket prayer squares that volunteers make, and then they can just contact us, and then we, you know, mail them to them, and Tiffany will say a prayer over them, and I'll say a prayer over them, and just a way to, you know, let them know that they're thought of and supported and
not alone.
A way to share some hope and encouragement with them.
Yeah, I love that. I love it. Sounds like it's almost like Tiffany ended up being a part of the family, basically.
Oh, she's a very dear friend, and really our story could not have gone more perfectly. She was just so wonderful through the whole pregnancy. And, you know, one of the things, I'll be really honest with you, one of the things that I was a little nervous about in the beginning was, you know, being envious of her or jealous of her because she was carrying, you know, our babies.
Yeah.
I never had any of those kind of feelings. Never.
Wow.
And I'm just so grateful. You know, Tiffany, that experience with her being our surrogate was a bonus round for us. And we had just been through so much loss that even though we weren't able to carry, I wasn't able to carry my babies, I was just so grateful that she was.
Mm-hmm.
So I never had any of those feelings, but
it might be a little different if you had not had a child before. Do you know what I'm saying? Like that was your only experience with having a child, someone else carrying it, that might sit a little bit differently.
Yeah, I think it might.
And personality obviously has to do with it too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. But, you know, surrogacy, I think we'll start to see it become more commonplace. And for anyone that's considering surrogacy, I would encourage it. I think it, you know, there are many ways for kids to come into families, adoption, fostering, mentoring, of course, IVF. There's so many different fertility treatments, but surrogacy is definitely a viable option.
Mm-hmm.
The only unfortunate part is that it's not inexpensive.
Yeah. Well, neither is like adoption. I mean,
no, adoption isn't cheap either, from what I understand.
Right.
Yeah. Or IVF.
None of it.
We mentioned that earlier. I was thinking about that when you said that your best friend offered, and it unfortunately didn't work out. I was thinking, would I carry my best friend's baby? I think I would. You know, if I saw her struggling through all that, I was like, you know, of course not now. I'm 45, so, you know, a little too old for, you know.
No, you're not.
the luggage isn't in the same shape it was a few years ago.
I've got a question about the embryos.
I get that.
How between the time you froze embryos and they were transferred, what was that length of time?
So Stella and Smith were frozen at 5 days old in the blastocyst stage, is what it's called, for 2 years.
So they're really
blows
six.
My mind.
Yeah.
Blows my mind. I mean, the technology and the science, I mean, Dr. Schoolcraft is nothing short of a fertility wizard. He has helped actually several friends of mine who tried for numbers of years with failed attempts. And, you know, he's wonderful, but there's also, I mean, there's fertility specialists that are amazing in every single state.
Yeah.
So you don't have to, you know, travel across the U.S. to, you know, Dr. Schoolcraft if that's something that's not possible. There's wonderful fertility specialists.
Do you think,
you know, available locally.
Your kids are going to use that, like when they're six or when they're 14, they're going to be like, I'm really 16. I feel like I would. Like, mom, like,
come on. I haven't thought about that. You know,
that's
when
funny.
The time comes when they can understand that, we'll have to have that chat.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's so bizarre.
That's funny.
Bizarre.
Yeah, it's like suspended animation almost. It's really strange thinking about it.
Yeah, I marvel at it. I mean, I really do. And, you know, every night when I go in and say goodnight to them and check on them one more time before I go to bed, to this day, and they're 4.5 years old, but to this day, I cannot believe they're here. Like, I marvel at them. I feel so blessed. I feel so lucky. And that's, again, why I'm just so passionate about helping other women, because I want to pay it forward. I'm just so grateful, you know, for what God has given us and feel so blessed. So
do you look for their breath every night?
Yeah. You make sure they're breathing. You know, I do. My son's 17. Yeah, I still do that.
I certainly did, you know, for the first year or so. But
not still now. Come on. I don't check every night. Maybe, I check probably about once a week.
I'm normal, right?
Do you really?
Yes.
Heather's actually trying to give me a hard time. Yeah.
So funny.
Yeah. So, you know, I'm a little bit paranoid, but you know,
nothing wrong with that. That's loved. The sign of a good mommy.
That's right. That's right. I love my big 17-year-old with stinky feet. That's what I'll never forget. A girlfriend of mine, when she's, you know, she used to watch him for me sometimes if I had to work. And she's like, and I was like, I just love kissing his little feet. She's like, yeah, wait till he's 16. You won't want to kiss his feet anymore.
Mm-hmm. I get that now. Aiden plays 4 different sports, so we are there.
Oh boy. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. I think it probably starts right around kindergarten, somewhere around there. They're just, the feet aren't cute anymore.
Or, no, they're, you know, not
they're cute, but they're stinky.
They are.
Baker, his aren't stinky yet, but he runs around the backyard with no shoes on and steps in Mexi's poop all the time. Like, he's just, ew. It's like he's got radar. I'm like, why? Like, legitimately why?
That is too funny.
He's
attracted to the poop.
No, I know. I don't even understand. Cause like, we will point it out. He keeps an eye out. He'll be like, Mexi poo-poo everywhere. And we're like, yes. Watch out for that poo-poo. He tells us that, but he just, I don't know. Luckily it's only been with shoes on, but still. Ugh, I know. I'm like, cool. So those shoes will stay outside until the poop comes off.
Yeah, exactly. Till it dries up and you can, you know, peel it off. Ew. Sorry. I didn't mean to get so graphic.
Thanks.
No. Hey. Not offended, believe you me.
Oh my gosh.
One thing I wanted to mention, so you know who really kind of gets left out a lot of times in the infertility world are the husbands or the partners. And so Dirk, I had him a couple of years ago when I first started this website. I had him write a letter, you know, just on behalf of the husbands or the partners, you know, just what his experience has been and what advice he gives. And it's really sweet. And so we have to give a shout out to the partners, you know, the spouses that are holding the hands of the one that's going through this, because, you know, they, even though they are not going through it in the physical sense, it's still a loss and it's still hard for them.
Yeah. I'm glad that you brought that up, because it is very easy to overlook the fact that, like you said, the partner or husband or whoever is going through this too, from a slightly different angle, but they're going through it too. And, and to be able to, and well, a lot of, I mean, y'all had 7 miscarriages. A lot of people, their marriage falls apart after one, you know, and the fact that you guys not only made it through all that and then move forward with the surrogacy stuff, I mean, it really is a testament to the strength of your marriage. Mm-hmm. I think that's really awesome.
Yeah. Well, thank you. And I mean, I will be very honest, you know, as I have been, we had some struggles. I mean, we went to my counselor together to sort through things, because I had put so much pressure on myself to give him this big family. So we had to really kind of navigate through all of that. And of course we did, but, you know, there were times where it wasn't easy, and it certainly was challenging for the two of us, you know, in our marriage, but our faith is what, you know, our foundation is and was. And so that's what got us through. And we started praying together when he was giving me my shots in my abdomen for IVF.
Yeah.
We would pray right before. So we still, to this day, every Monday morning, we get together and, you know, pray over our marriage, our kids, whatever we're going to be tackling that week. And it's just become this tradition, and it really, it's really sweet, and it's really bonded us and made us stronger.
That's cool. I mean, it's almost kind of like, even again, too, if you're not a big prayer kind of person, I think just putting that out there, putting those vibes out there, even if you don't want to mm-hmm. pray necessarily, just getting together and saying, you know what, let's really focus on the good things this week and our, you know, each other and our kids or whatever you want to put out there, the positivity out there in the universe, you know, mm-hmm. and between the two of you. And like you said, it's a bonding moment even. I think that's really cool. That's such a great idea.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And you're right. It doesn't have to be, I mean, cause Dirk and I had never really prayed together out loud. So it was kind of awkward in the beginning. you know, like, okay, what do I say and how do I say it? And praying out loud in general, especially when you first start out doing it, it can be kind of, you know, intimidating. Yeah. Whether it's meditating or just like before you leave each other on Monday morning, if you're, you know, like just hug each other and, you know, spend, you know, 30 seconds in each other's arms and just say, you know, whisper what you want for them that week. You know, I want you to have a great week and be successful and I want you to feel loved and protected or whatever it is. Yeah. It's a great way to start your week.
Wow.
It really
is. Look at this. Like, geez, Stephanie, you're just full of all kinds of pearls of wisdom.
Oh,
seriously.
Very sweet. Well, so. I wish that we could, you know, chat in person with a bottle of champs and
me too. I'd be down with that.
We can. Well, I can.
I can too.
Cause we'll be in Oklahoma at some point.
Well, again, the book is called Angel Wings. It's going to be out in August. Stephanie O'Hara, thank you so much for your time and everything.
Yes.
Oh my gosh. You're so welcome. It is my pleasure. I really enjoy getting to chat with the two of you. You're so funny and fun and sweet and I love your podcast, and I just am so honored to be your guest.
Well, thank you for spreading your wisdom upon us and our listeners, because Lord knows we all need it.
Oh, for sure.
Oh,
especially now.
Well, thanks.
Well, thank you again. And if anybody wants to send us an email, iCan'tMomTodayPodcast@gmail.com. And of course, you can find us on YouTube, iCan'tMomTodayPodcast. Same thing on Twitter and Instagram and Facebook, iCan'tMomToday. If you have suggestions or comments, constructive criticisms, constructive. we're open to it. Thank you one more time, Stephanie. Until next time. Bye.
You are so welcome. Should we howl?
Oh, ooh, yeah, let's howl. There you go. Ready? 1, 2, 3.
Howl!
You definitely have to Facebook Live that.
Yeah.
Love it.